Being a missions director, I had always thought, wow, what an awesome job. Like, you know, because the people that have come before me were able to travel all over the place and I think, you know, visited a lot of the world. And even though I have traveled a lot, the Lord told me, like, don't get too ahead of yourself because really your job is here. You know, your job is to be here. You're supporting Pastor Carter. You know, he's the one that God has given a vision to. And really, your job is to manage that vision and help to see that vision come to pass. And so, in doing that, I'm going to just, and the Lord was like, so like, I'm going to help you out. I'm going to bring the people to you. I'm like, wow. I wanted to go to them. And he's like, no, I want you to, I'm going to bring them to you. So I'm like, no, but let me just embrace that. Let me accept what God has called me to do. And let me accept where he's called me to be, to serve under, to serve you, to serve the church, and just be excited about that. And sure enough, the Lord started to just transform the office. And it not only has the Lord been bringing people, I mean, if the 3 o'clock service, which I was picking up Luli at the airport, you know, she and a couple were coming back from Ethiopia, but, you know, Pastor Jules that was here from the church in Baghdad, I mean, look what God is bringing. You know, you look at people like that, you look at, you know, so much wealth of spiritual understanding, seasoned men of God, ministries that are solid. These are the people that God is bringing to Times Square Church, and these are the very people that God is connecting us with that you guys are going to be the ones going out and visiting, you know. So it is your joy, it is your privilege, and that's why we're here, is to really kind of start to set a tone, because you are what, in my mind, you are the class of 2008. You know, like, if there was going to be a high school yearbook, this would be your year. You know, so all of you are going to have, like, your little spot in that year. But, you know, looking at, like, what does that really mean, you know, in the spiritual terms? Like, you know, because, you know, I'm going to show you a video in a second about, you know, I had wanted to say, oh, let me just show them the first missions trip video. And we were going crazy looking for these things, and finally I found one, and Tim ran out to get it duplicated so that we could watch it on a DVD player. And, you know, he's like, Treg, there's only sound on this, because these VHS tapes are so old that the image has disappeared. But you realize, when you see the one that we did find that was from 1996, and when you hear what they're talking about, you'll realize that the pictures may have changed, but the message remains unchanged. And the same things that are discussed in that, and that's why I want you to listen closely to what you're hearing. I'm going to try to get it transcribed so that you can read it, because I want to read it again. Because some of the nuggets in that video, what they're saying is the same stuff that I feel is so important for us today. Because you are on a trip, even though you're going as a corporate body, you're alone in your relationship with the Lord. Because in the end of the day, you are going to stand before the Lord alone and give an account for what he's given you to be responsible with. And what he's given you is his son. He gave the best he had, and he's entrusted it to you. And now you're going to go, and what you're going to do with it is what he wants to know. What are you going to do with this? And so as I prayed this morning, the Lord kept giving me a little picture. And it wasn't until just sitting back there, you know, as they were finishing worship, that I feel like I understood what the Lord was saying, is that all morning and this whole day, I have seen an ocean with these waves coming off the ocean, and there's just a, you know, like this kind of like this stormy beach, and all that I could see is just like, why these waves just that keep rolling up and rolling across the sand? And the Lord's like, you know, no, you have to understand that the body is like the body of the ocean, the body of Christ. There's all these people in there. And he said, and what you're doing is you're just picking up one season, one wave of what I'm doing. And you guys are that wave. And this is your moment to come and crash on the sand, because it's the repeating and the repeating and the repeating and the repeating that makes the difference. That's what changes coastlines. That's what changes the way something looks. It doesn't happen just from one wave coming across the ocean. It happens from this repeat that only God can bring. Only God knows how each wave is formed. And when you look at a wave, you realize that nothing is the same in a wave. It starts out in one spot, it ends in another, and even if you are the little piece of water droplet that's on the inside that seems like it's falling short from everybody else, it's still the wave, it's still the water, and it's still getting to the sand. You know, so you're not, don't look at how you see yourself. You are part of something bigger. All of your failings, all of your weakness, all the junk you think you carry, all the stuff, doesn't matter. Even the expectations that you may think that we have of you, you just can just let those go, because we don't have expectations. You know, we are we are just expecting God to do something in you and through you and to you. You know, and so with all that, like, you know, just sit back and enjoy this video, and then it's maybe like 9 minutes long, so you can just, you know, don't expect it to end quick. Just enjoy it, and then even at the end, what they're doing is they're going to talk for a while. You'll see a bunch of pictures and then a little song. But while that song is playing and you're just looking at the faces of these kids in Russia, think about something that struck you as you were listening to that video, okay? I don't know. I see how nice that. I liked it again, just sitting there watching it over. And not because of, again, not what we saw in what was happening with the kids, because, you know, that's a, you know, that's fairly standard, you know, the outreach type of approach that we're doing in a lot of the trips that we do. But it's the life that you're living. You know, Pastor Carter, if, you know, as you listen through this last year of messages, one of the things that I've heard over and over this year is you may be the only Bible that anybody reads. It's not going to be so much what you say. You know, a lot of you are going to be going to places where the language is not going to be something you're going to even be able to speak. You may not even end up with a translator. You know, somebody else may be the one that's getting to use the translator. And you are just going to be there. And you're going to be thinking, I came all the way here to do this. And I'm going to say, yes, you went all the way there to do that. Because if that's what God has called you to do, who are we to question how he's going to use it, you know? And it's, you know, you look at any of these missions trips, a perspective for me is most of these trips are close to 2 weeks. So you've got 2 weeks that you're going to be in another country, and you've got 50 weeks that you're going to be right here. So it's pretty clear to me that God is going to take you there. He's going to use you, and you're going to bless somebody else for a few minutes. But really, the deeper lasting work is actually going to be in you to come home. Because there is something that he's doing here. This is a pivotal time in history. This is even in New York City. You look at what God is doing through Times Square Church and things like prayer in the square. There's a lot happening right here. You know, you look at the world politics, or you look at the economic picture of New York City, the United States. Things are changing. You know, and we have the opportunity to do this now, which is exciting, but all of this, look at all of it as a classroom for you in your relationship with the Lord. So one of the first things that I would say to be for you as homework, and this is your own homework that your team leader will never check on, probably, but it is your homework, is please take this next week and reevaluate your relationship with the Lord. Don't ask the Lord in your prayer time, what are you going to have me do while I'm gone? What are you going to have me, what is the challenge that you're going to put before me? Just do personal inventory. When we did that prayer and fasting last week, and that was one of the things that, I don't even remember which night it was or where I heard it, but something caught my ear in the spirit when one of the pastors prayed about spiritual inventory. Like, do an inventory of your life. Ask God again, what's going on in your devotional life? Where is your devotional life landed? I mean, a lot of us started out with great intentions over here, and we have gotten so caught up in either work or ministry and ministry activity that you can't use that replacement. You can't replace your time with the Lord with ministry work and think that you're going to be full or satisfied. And I will tell you that I am one of the first ones to tell you that that is my biggest struggle, is where do I find time? You know, we've got a 2-year-old back here, and I try to get up at 5:15, 5:30, just to manage to make the time. But somehow she can sometimes guess when we're getting up too. You know, so it's like if she wants to get up at 5:30, then you're still trying to, like, how do I work around this? And you realize God knows how to help you. But he's actually just checking your heart to say, do you even want to? Because that's half of it right there. Do you even want to spend time with the Lord? You know, because, you know, there's a lot of little issues that can come in your heart. And that's where what we're doing in training, and that's where these next few weeks, we're going to do 6 weeks here in this room as a group, in a sense, where we're going to try to just cover some basic things, because I do want you, as we go out into the field, wherever you go, we want you to represent one voice. You know, you are one voice and one spirit. We're actually under an authority. So we're going to go out and we are representing the Lord first, Times Square Church, and Pastor Dave and Pastor Carter. You know, so we are actually ambassadors for Times Square Church wherever we go. And so we want to be on the same page. You want to be saying the same things to people. So that's a lot of the basic stuff we're going to cover. But once your 6 weeks are over from here, that's when you're really, your team is going to start to really gel, and you're going to start really spending the rest of your time until the trip goes out with your team leader. And so what you're, you know, when you're looking at, listen here to all the things that we're, you know, discussing corporately, but realize that you're going to deal with, in the training, all the ugly stuff, I hope. All the stuff about the person next to you that you don't like, the fact that somebody like, why is it that this person has missed 4 trainings and nobody even cares? Doesn't even seem like even many even notices. You know, there's stuff like that, little stuff is going to rattle your cage, I can guarantee you. And I can guarantee you that somebody talks too loud, and I can tell you that somebody talks way too much, and why does that person always want to pray? Because that person never lets anybody else talk, they just want to pray. But those are the kind of things that's what this time is for. Because you want to be able to sit down and a lot of times go home and ask the Lord, why is that irritating me so much? Why does it bother me that person likes to pray so much? Why does it bother me that person always has to be the one that gets all the attention? And why does it bother me that nobody notices me? You know, these are all little questions that if you will allow this time and take it seriously, that it's not the teaching stuff that we give you, but it's the little responses. If you will actually allow the Lord to quicken those little responses that you're having, and that in your private time when you're doing your devotions, you can actually say, God, help me to remember some of those stupid little things that were driving me crazy, so that I can ask you, why do I keep dealing with that? Because if you're anything like me, if you will actually stop and think about that little thing that person's doing that's bothering you, you may just find out that there's 17 other people that are also the same little thing is bothering you about those people. And if you ask the Lord, he may just say, well, that's my issue with you. And then comes the even tougher part, is recognizing that God has an issue with you. And well, how do I deal with this now? Like, you can quote yourself all the scripture verses you want to, but are you allowing them to change you? Can you actually live through them? It's much harder if you personalize all this stuff than actually just, you know, well, try to, let me just put the mirror on all you, you know, like, that's what kind of sometimes what we want to do is like, no, I know you've got a problem with me. Let me tell you that you let me deal with it with you. But no, turn it inward and ask God, no, change me, really. This time, change me. I don't want to be this person anymore. I don't want to be like this anymore. And the Lord has been taking me on a little journey this last couple of months where there has been stuff that I have not realized that, and I think I shared it at the, you know, during the prayer we had on Wednesday night, and Pastor Carter had asked us to share from a psalm. And I had shared a little bit, but, you know, what I shared was just one quick, like, anecdote. But what the Lord was actually challenging was, you know, have you gotten so stiff in your thinking that you've embraced stuff that is just so routine? It's so routine in the way that you process everything you do that you forget that sometimes that routine thinking is just wrong. It's not the Lord. It doesn't promote anything. It doesn't promote godliness. It doesn't promote purity. It doesn't promote any of the righteous things that we want to be, the things that we actually might even think we are. And God is saying, no, I want to do something with you, because you know what? And this is where God is so merciful and he's so good. He says, the best is yet to come. There's something good that God is doing in you, and he wants to keep doing something in us. It's an ongoing work that God is working in us. And so allow this season of training to be something that is yucky for you, like that you feel a little bit like mucked up on the inside, that you're, you know, that be rejoicing if you are troubled by the person that's in your team that you're dealing with, because then you realize that, no, God is really pointing at something. And that you can get it out, because we were talking about it before the meeting even started, that in the end of the day, when the trip is done, if every team just that the host reported to me, no, people knew this group was Christians because of the love they had for one another, I would be thrilled. Because that kind of a testimony, I don't need to hear how many people, you know, oh, accepted the Lord. That will happen. But if someone could just say that, and to be honest, like even last year, we did get trips that is all the host said. So it is in you. There is, that is your potential. It can happen. You know, that's what the testimony will be, is that these people were different because of how they were able to walk together. They walked in unity. They were submissive to their authority that was over them. They were able to just do what they were called to do, no matter how big or how little. They would actually meet their fears and walk forward instead of shrinking back. You know, some of you are going to be called to give a message at a church. Some of you are going to be asked to do things that you just don't think you can do. I don't think I can do this. I can tell you right now, this is not my... Any one of my staff will tell you, I usually sweat. That's why this little napkin is here. Because I get so nervous. I never feel like I have a thing to say. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm like, it's all a big mush. But then somehow the Lord uses that mush, you know. But I have to go through this sweaty process of just being willing to stand there and do what's uncomfortable for me. But you guys are going to be asked to praise and worship at different times. You're going to be thrown into situations that maybe are not so easy. And like I was saying, for some of you, to sit still is super hard. And that's the truth. There's sometimes like you're somewhere and everything is not going the way that you want it to, or the team, your host has worked on everything and it just, the bus didn't happen. The church said they couldn't have you, and why are you here? That's the beauty of the Lord, because God doesn't think of any of those things as a mistake. Those are all divinely ordered. And so even if you're just sitting there, there will be a reason why you're just sitting there, and He will make sure that you can see it. So that's what for us, like, just, I want you to have that ingrained in your mind. The expectations, just as if you open the window, just let that bird expectation fly away. Because you don't need to hold that anymore. Let go of it. Even with what you're doing here, just let go of that and allow the Lord to, just like the beginning of the video, do something new. He wants to do a new thing. Let it be something new in you and go a new direction. You may come home and find that what God wants you to do is to just bake cookies for the school next to you. It may not even be at a ministry at Times Square Church. It's okay. There's plenty of stuff to do in this city where you could be sharing the love of Christ. And you just, if God is telling you to do it, obedience is what, the other thing I think would be one of my little catchphrases lately is, are you just willing to do what God is telling you to do? For all of you here, to me, this is an obedience thing. You're here because God has told you to do something. He's asked you to go on this trip for whatever reasons, so you're here. So you're already like one check for obedience. Yes, I'm here. You know, so you're on your way to listening. You know, but these are all little things that if you enjoy this process, I believe God will take you to new heights in what you're, you know, what you're doing, where you're at, and we will be a stronger body here when things are tough. And we are called not to go across the sea, but to actually go to the boroughs, because they need us in the boroughs. There's something happening in the city, and it's just that, no, this is our new mission field is home, you know. So with that, I just welcome you again, and these next few weeks of training that were coming, they will all continue to grow and change and develop as we go. I think we have next week's already set, but the one that was for the third week is already not coming. So I'm already, it's always just this constant wait on the Lord for what He wants to do. And so we keep waiting, but it'll be exciting.